Hi, what's up? This is Postdoc Chronicles week number 73, and today we're featuring Resident Evil 5. Of course, Resident Evil 6 was featured in the last Postdoc Chronicles. So this game right here, so it's starting the cinematic scenes, but let's go to the title screen. Yeah, so this game right here, I've played it for the first time back in around, like I said before, back in around 2012. It's actually like one of the benchmarks that I had in getting my laptop. So this is my like MSI laptop, my second laptop when I was transitioning from my MS going to PhD. So I bought a new laptop from I used like the fund from DOST to buy this one. I believe I bought this for like 32,000 back then. And then one of the things that I really needed when I look for a new laptop, this is old now, but I still use it sometimes because I'm using a Mac. Sometimes if I need some Windows stuff, you know, for things involving like retro game hacking and programming and stuff like that, that does not run on a Mac, I still boot up my Windows. But yeah, so the first game that I played here is actually Resident Evil 5. So Resident Evil 5 was the benchmark that I needed in order to buy a new laptop back in 2012. And so I did. I was able to buy that laptop that was able to run Resident Evil 5. And yeah, I played it right away. I finished it right away. It was really good during that time. Like I said before, fans were divided because this went the route of action Resident Evil. It's so action-packed. You know, a lot of like guns ablazing, a lot of bullets instead of like, you know, the survival elements that Resident Evil was known for in the earlier games of the series. And even though it divided the fans, it's still highly acclaimed. You know, it got very, very positive reviews. And for me personally, I still love it because, like I said before, my position for Resident Evil, I don't really think it's a horror game. It's more like the badassery of being able to kill mutated monsters. And I believe one of the reasons why fans, you know, like was shocked about how this game came out is because when it first they showed the trailer earlier for this, it was actually just Chris Redfield, you know, who was featured in this game initially, and it looked really creepy. The atmosphere was a little bit horror because he was alone, and then later on when they released the actual game, they told the fans that it will actually feature two players with Sheva Alomar. So this is actually the game that kickstarted, you know, the body system in Resident Evil, which they continued in Resident Evil 6, but I believe they stopped using that in Resident Evil 7. I haven't played that yet, but yeah. So Resident Evil 5 is again, it's an action game. It's based in South Africa. No, not South Africa. It's in the continent of Africa. I believe it's called the Kijuju. And yeah, so I'm going to replay this while in South Africa because, you know, it has that nice feeling of playing a game that is set on the continent with where you're currently at. So while I'm in South Africa, then I'm going to replay Resident Evil 5, which itself is based on in Africa, is set in Africa. And yeah, so the nice thing about Resident Evil series for me personally in general is, again, they've always been like the empathy or the reason, the motivation why I get some stuff. So for example, to give you an example, the one of the reasons why I really wanted a PS1. So my very first PS1, I got it from my college colleague, a friend of mine, Eliel Paglinawan. He sold me his PlayStation, I believe, for 1,000 pesos or 2,000 pesos. It was already during the time when PlayStation 1 was like already, you know, an old toy, like PS3 was already famous during that time. But yeah, I really wanted to have that because I really wanted to play Resident Evil 1, 2, and 3 on that console. And then after that, when I was taking my MS, I believe the first or second Christmas break when I went back to Dumaguete, I bought a PlayStation 2 in Manila. And again, the main reason why I bought PlayStation 2 is so that I can play Resident Evil 4 on it. And then eventually, I bought a new laptop just so I can play Resident Evil 5. And in fact, also, the reason why I bought my original 3DS, this is not my first 3DS, this is the current one I'm using. This is a new 3DS regular. But anyway, the reason why I bought a new 3DS or a 3DS back in the day is so that I can play Resident Evil Revelations. And also, one of the reasons, not the main reason, of course, I would admit, the main reason why I bought a Nintendo Switch is, of course, because of Super Mario Odyssey. But of course, again, one of the games that really pushed me into it is the fact that the Resident Evil Revelations collection is also coming to the Nintendo Switch. So now I have like Resident Evil Revelations 1 and 2 on my Switch. I also have the first Resident Evil Revelation on my 3DS, and then currently I have like Resident Evil 0, 1, Resident Evil 4, 5, and 6 on my Nintendo Switch. So yeah, so that's it right there. But yeah, so it's really a very nice series and I really love it. But anyway, before going to Postdoc Chronicles, very quickly, Just yesterday on the trash bin section of the bookstore that I really love in Witwatersrand at Wits. Let me go to the title screen because the light is flickering. It's confused with, you know, the lightings. But anyway, so just I was saying that the place where I kept on getting some really old classic sci-fi collections that like twice now I've got like a whole book haul there. Just yesterday, you know, I saw some very good science books that when you convert it to Philippine peso, it's only less than 70 pesos. So these are the ones I got. The Universe, a Biography by John Gribben. So this is like a Lemanized cosmology. So it's one of the things that, you know, I read from time to time. It's really nice. It talks about like the Big Bang. What are the theories that we have about the, you know, the possible origins of the universe, where it's going to, etc. Another book, Four Colors of Ice by Robin Wilson. This talks about, so this is like a nice mathematical account of the so-called four color problem or the four color theorems, you know, saying that what's the least number of colors that you need in order to color a map such that neighboring countries, so you have like a random map with a randomized, you know, divisions, so that two neighboring countries or adjacent countries, not just two, any adjacent countries would have unique colors. Okay, so that's why they said it's a conjecture that maybe only four is needed, the minimum amount. But then like the proof was really hard, and then eventually it got like a numerical proof, and then there's like a huge debate whether, oh, that's like a computer proof, it doesn't count. So whether, you know, a brute force proof really counts in mathematics and stuff like that. So it's well accounted here. I'm still gonna read that. The Invention of Hair is like a biography of Joseph Priestley. This is by Stephen Johnson, and his experiments that led to the discovery of oxygen. I believe this is good. And then Decoding the Heavens, an account of this thing called the Antikythera mechanism. So it's like an ancient machine that they thought was a mechanical computer. You know, it can do calculations and stuff like that. You know, so sometimes when the word computer comes to mind, people would think like, oh, these things that you need to, you know, you need to plug into an electricity. But no, a computer is not like that. So basically, it's a computer that can do algorithms. You know, that can do tasks. So it doesn't matter how you carry them out. It just turns out that during our current era, the most efficient way to do it is, you know, via electrical signals. But, you know, before, even then, earlier, you know, there were like designs involving mechanical like gears and wheels and stuff like that without electricity, but can do algorithms that can perform calculations. And then this, you know, explores the machine that was discovered. You know, it looks like something like that, that they think was an ancient calculator. They said that maybe that was the very first computer. And finally, this is the one I'm reading right now, the book Nobody Read. Mike Solis told me about this book. It's an account of, you know, Nicolas Copernicus' De Revolutionibus, a very famous book that, you know, says that what if the Earth is not the center of the solar system, but rather the Sun, and then all the planets revolve around it. Because before that, people thought that the Earth is at the center, and then all the other celestial bodies that they observe revolved around the Earth. And so someone, a historian, claimed that during those times, nobody actually read Nicolas Copernicus' book. So this is like by Owen Gingerich. Decoding the Heavens is by Joe Marchant, okay, if you're interested. But anyway, this one is like the adventure. This guy is a science historian. It's like he wanted to really prove whether or not people did not actually read Copernicus' treatise during that time when it was published in like during the 1500s. But it turns out, yeah, the people actually read it, but it's a very nice account. So I'm already like in chapter 3, and so far it looks very good. And very quickly, Postdoc Chronicles. So this week, we are now doing Deepak and I talk, so we will now be beginning my qualification tasks. The things that we're looking at right now are, so there are two. He narrowed it down into two. So one would involve the Rivet code, and I think it's something to do with tuning and, you know, making sure that the Rivet does some correct stuff. But the other one, and maybe this will be the one that I'll be doing, is it involves pileups. You know, so basically when you collide stuff, you can't really have like a single proton and a single proton. Most of the time, they come into like groups of protons. So how would you account for those errors, you know, interactions that would come from the other protons instead of the proton that you're actually looking at? So that's pile up. So maybe my work would also involve that. So Deepak would still ask the Atlas people whether which of these would be most the most priority to be done for the qualification task. So we'll choose between the two. And then also Lawrence and I are now beginning to do this, you know, the ones that I talked before, the search for the right-handed neutrino. And then we are doing this, we're constructing this large jet with an electron inside or a muon inside. So Lawrence is going to look at the electron portion of the project, then I'm gonna look at the muon one. So it's gonna be, Lawrence is a PhD student, but I think he's more expert than I am when it comes to experimental physics because he's been doing it for a longer time. I think he's almost done with this qualification task as well. Okay, and also the CMS proposal that I made that I gave to the Philippines, I already gave it to them. So I still don't think it's good enough, you know, but I only had a little time to come up with it. So I did the best I could. I read a lot of B physics review papers. And finally, my collaborators from Finland, Oleg, Subhadip, and all this stuff, and also John from Germany, we are already beginning to write the draft of the paper on Dihigs, because Subhadip has really very nice results from his, you know, boosted decision tree. Again, personally, I still haven't done that, but John said it's fine. We're gonna focus on the portion of the paper that involves the searches relevant on our final states, you know. So that's what I'm gonna do. So searches that is the strongest in constraining our particular model, and then how to recast them, and yeah. So I'm gonna look over those particular searches and then see if it can really constrain the results that Subhadip has. And then our goal is, by December, you know, we can come up with a draft. But yeah, so anyway, this has been Postdoc Chronicles week number, what's this again? 73. And I'll see you now next time for Postdoc Chronicles week number 74. Thanks for watching. I'm going back now to school, and bye-bye.